Thank you. 10-4. about 5 foot long dark hair, got tie-dye shirt on, and number 21 is on.
Switch it on, here comes the throttle. Every breaker's in. We have separation routine. Inboard, outboard, they're on. We're coming forward with the sightseeing. I've got a blowout. Number 3. Introduce the 0. Mix it up. Can't hold out the 2. We're in general mode. So I'll try to collect it emergency. My God, I can't hold it. She's breaking up. She's breaking up.
Hey guys, good morning. Thank you for being patient yesterday. Sorry, just had some after effect trouble from a treatment, and much better now. I was over it a few hours, like by lunch, but just was had to recover kind of all day. So that's why I didn't go live last night. I planned to go live and talk about what we were yesterday's events in the Karen Reed trial. So we'll go over that a little bit this morning. Let's just say good morning to everybody. Thank you, Lori, Joey. Yes, doing better. Eldon, am I going to be shaking down local businesses today? Yes, yes. I was going around like Whitey Bulger in town the other day, and Dave McGrath and his son were my henchmen. They were my muscle, especially his youngest son. That kid's tough. You know, everybody was terrified. Just what a crazy day. Yeah, we went into a store, Cassie's Corner Convenience, that was listed on the discovery video from that store, which is not has not been submitted by the prosecution, and we're going to get into that too. We have some new information on that, and so that's the woman in the store. Even though we were nothing but polite and friendly to her, especially Dave was extra friendly, but I was just my usual polite self, and we were in and out in a minute. Sent surveillance from it out. I don't know if she sent it directly to Sean sent it to someone else that sent it to Sean, but it got there pretty quick. And Sean was boastfully putting it on Twitter as though to say, see, I got eyes and ears everywhere. But it's particularly disturbing for the Albert family to find out that someone who has been avowedly a supporter of theirs and part of their lives for decades is secretly into shit like this. And it doesn't even mean that that person and that owns the store believes that Karen is innocent. I have no idea what she believes. But what it does show you is the enormous tendency for people with a big case like this to want to have them in the sun, to get drawn into it, you know, to want to be a part of things, to be relevant. And so to her, I guess me and Dave were like celebrities. And so she wanted to send that out. So she goes and grabs it from the surveillance video. I mean, if you want to treat us like celebrities, then just say, hey, do you mind if we take a picture? I mean, we're not celebrities. It's crazy. But in this weird case, who knows, right? Nobody else. We were discreet in town. We didn't go we didn't shoot any video. We tried to take a little video on my phone at Pequotside Farm, but I screwed it up. I gave it to Dave's son to do the filming, but I hadn't started it properly. You could tell he did a great job, and I screwed it up. But that's it. We wanted to get in and get out unseen. That was definitely the goal, and that's what we did. We didn't go. I didn't go into D&E Pizza. I didn't go into the waterfall. We didn't go into CJ McCarthy's. So we just mostly were in the car, just trying to inspect the sites that we talk about on our shows so we can have a better sense of it. And that's it. The last thing we wanted was to create really anti-turtle. We're the opposite of that. We didn't want to be noticed. I did the best I could to wear a disguise. I put on sunglasses. So Dave sent me a picture last night that his son took of us in front of the waterfall. That's the closest thing we did to looking like tourists. And I don't even think I want to publish it. The photo came out great, but I'm not even sure I want to publish it right now because it seems almost disrespectful. Like we're turning this into a stunt, you know, and it wasn't at all what we were doing. So, but it's just the craziness of this case. Good morning, everybody. Emily down in Tennessee. Hopefully it's nice and warm and spring is well underway down there. Coffee Kristen, hi, good to see you. Jules, good morning. And Everybody else who's quietly watching but can't say anything in chat, I know you're there. So appreciate you, love you, and thank you for being with us. Boy, the coverage of this case is just so bad. It's so filled with disinformation. It's incredible. So I'm going to let me bring up on the screen the motions from yesterday that has the evidence that's going to be used by the prosecution and the witness list, that kind of stuff. All right, let's see. I don't think it's going to let me make it any bigger. So we'll just read from it, though. A lot of people just listen on their phones anyways. All right. So it begins with an outline of the case, but then we can skip that. And I think one thing that's not on this list, but the judge ruled on the third-party culprit theory. And this is really interesting and powerful if you look at the way she's done this. So she says this: the defense is not allowed to introduce the idea of a third-party culprit in their opening statement. And that's huge, because that opening statement really captures the attention of the jury and the public, of course, but of the jury. So taking that out of their hands is big. She's basically saying there's no evidence for this. But she did say you're allowed to bring it up during the trial if the evidence develops it. So if something comes from evidence or witnesses, they're allowed to work it in. But for now, they can't bring it up. And that's a very powerful ruling. That means that in none of the motions or in none of the arguments that they've made in court, have they convinced the judge that there is any evidence for a third-party culprit theory. There's no evidence to back it up. And it's important, because you can't just go out there and wildly, you can't just say, you know, for instance, a lawyer can't go out there and say, I believe that Joe Biden is behind this murder, or Donald Trump is behind this murder. It was part of some, like one of Eldon's kind of theories. Eldon, if you're still here, Eldon has some entertaining theories on a lot of things, and usually they're mostly just tongue-in-cheek. But you can't throw something like that out in your opening statement. There are limitations. There has to be some basis for it. And so it's obvious the judge, who has read all the federal material, all the material submitted by the state, by the defense, heard all the arguments in court, She's seen zero evidence to suggest that John went in the house. Zero evidence to suggest he was killed by anybody else. And so she wants to let the defense have this tool, because it's an important tool for any defense team to be able to point to somebody else, especially in a case like this where there's no witness, no video of what happened at 34 Fairview. So I do think there's some interesting things about that, just from a common sense bartender logic kind of way. Say you're accused of being involved in a hit and run in a city. It's easier to put this in a city, right? So let's say in the city of Worcester, you're involved in a hit and run. You're not involved. You're accused of being of hit and run. And the evidence seems to show that your car later on, that your car really wasn't even in an accident, right? And so your experts are going to say, I don't know why they're accusing us, because we weren't even in, this vehicle looks like it wasn't even in an accident. Now, it shouldn't be up to you to show who actually did hit the pedestrian. That should be up to the state. It shouldn't be up to you to go and investigate and find out who did this. You know, so I don't really know where the lines of the law are here, but definitely they're going. It's not, the judge is not just making this stuff up out of thin air. She's going by law and precedent, which has the weight of law in other cases. So she's looking at that, and they're saying you have to demonstrate some kind of a person who has opportunity and who has a plausible motive. You don't have to prove it, but you have to show that it's a reasonable possibility. So I don't know. It's really tricky to me. Like, how would you, if it was a hit and run that you were innocent of, but you had no idea who actually did it, how would you be able to come up with that? I don't really understand. So I'm not sure. And that wasn't really addressed very well in the hearing so far. So anyway, so let's look at the evidence that the state plans to present. And there's a lot up here, so we'll just, I'll read through it quickly, but we'll stop and highlight something if it seems interesting. Certified copy of the death certificate. This is something that's important to the defense because they were trying to say there wasn't a death certificate, or they were trying to, it's typical on a death certificate to not be specific about the cause of death. And the word, the way it was wording on there was something that the defense wants to exploit to suggest that the state doesn't know how John died. And that's not really accurate. So it's a distort. The defense is going to seize on words that are a little bit, that might have two meanings, right? And they're going to try to present to the jury the second meaning in order to try to confuse them. So there was a lot of actually discussion about what was allowed on the wording of the death certificate. Copy of the 911 calls, of course. Copy of Canton Police Department photos. The Canton police officers do not wear body cams. So I'm not sure. Oh, those would probably be photos that were taken at the scene, however. So I don't know if that may suggest that the Canton police did take some photos there after John was taken away by ambulance. We'll see. I've never seen. There is some photos that seems to show the curb and the snow. So maybe they did take some photos. A copy of Ring videos from One Meadows Avenue. That's John's home. So we're going to hear some interesting things on that. I have some new stuff on that, but I can't really report it because I haven't been able to confirm it with, it's from a very good source, but I haven't been able to confirm it from a second source yet. So I'm not going to say anything about it, but I think there's going to be some interesting things, interesting developments with the Ring video, including obviously the prosecution is, well, we know for a fact that their video was missing. Was it deleted? And who deleted it? When was it deleted? You know, from what computer was it deleted, or was it from, was it deleted from a phone? Those are things that should be determinable, right? Boy, that's a tough word to say at this time of the morning. Determinable. How am I saying that right? Sorry, guys, you have to bear with me. I'm still not through my first cup of coffee. I don't know about you guys. Do you guys have this? This is obviously for anybody younger there, you wouldn't know what I'm talking about. But for older people, I find that my vision is not quite as good when it comes to reading things until I've had like my full cup of coffee. So I don't normally wear glasses. I do wear reading glasses if I'm looking at small things on my phone or at a book. But otherwise, I don't wear any glasses. But I find my vision is just enough. It's not quite right in the morning. I don't know. Crazy stuff, right? Anyway, so the Ring video did... were the police, were the prosecution able to recover any of the images that have been deleted, right? Because those images are stored potentially on a server by Ring's server. That would be really interesting. Before I continue on the list, I'm going to go back to chat, see who's there, make sure. I always have to check to make sure like my mic hasn't come undone or something like that. So while we're here, we'll take the chance to say hi to people that I haven't already said hi to. So Jimmy H is talking to coffee. All right, Heather, good to see you. Good morning. And anybody, if something goes on, if the actual hearing becomes, actually, I'm going to go to, I've heard that, Nesson has said, NECN has said they're going to cover all of the case. So we were on there yesterday. Okay, so I have, I'm not sure. I'll do that. I'm going to go off this list and I'll continue to read from it from you. But I'm going to go to NECN, so in case something comes on, you guys will see it and you'll know that we're not missing anything.
Four so far have been selected. So let's bring in NBC Channel's Minash Gori live outside Norfolk Superior Court. Minash, safe to say, this is...
Okay, this is obviously, they're saying live and it's pitch dark, so this is obviously not live. It was live at the time that it was recorded, but this is what they're playing right now. So let's see. I think it'll just come live if it comes on, but you guys can keep me in touch if something comes on in court and I'm missing it. So we'll keep that there. And I'll just read from the evidence list and the witness list. Have I ever heard how Eric Steele says how a medical examiner state how to a person did not know? I don't know. That's not worded well, but I mean, I think you get into difficult issues here because sometimes you don't know for sure what the specific cause of death was, and even in terms of the body. So if you have multiple injuries, it could be a combination of things. So I think it's this is why it's important to hear and listen to the actual expert testimony, as opposed to, which is, in today's world, we're not conditioned to that. We want to hear things summarized for us, like in a movie. And a trial is not going to be that. It's going to be extremely meticulous and going over every little detail. And it's going to be, even if it's the O.J. Simpson case, if you look at the dramatic moments, yes, it's fascinating. But if you actually have to watch the minute-by-minute play of a trial, it's not always exciting because they have to be very, very meticulous. So, all right. So let me get back to this list. So it could be interesting stuff with the Ring video. Did they recover any deleted video? Do they know the times that and from where the video was deleted? Copy of surveillance from the waterfall. Copy of receipt from the waterfall. This would show how many drinks they had. Copy of surveillance from C.J. McCarthy's. Copy of receipts from C.J. McCarthy's. Copy of MSPCL CSS photos. So now Mass State Police Chem Lab, I assume. CL is probably for the Chem Lab. That's the team that I'm guessing. I don't really know. But that's the team that comes in and goes over every inch of the car for any kind of evidence. MSP scene photos. That's the CERT team. So that's all the stuff at 34 Fairview, that the evidence team, that's when you see the guys going out there with shovels to dig up the snow on the whole scene over a wide area to collect whatever they find for evidence. Copy of surveillance from the video from the town library. So this is now the video from the town library shows them going to 34, does not show Karen coming home, but then later on does show her go by. So remember that, because I'm going to come back to that, because I think this is a key piece of evidence that we can extrapolate some understanding when we look at what's not included here. So actually, I'll just go into it right now. So what's not included on this list is something that had been in discovery was video from Cassie's Corner Convenience, where they like to distribute surveillance photos of people. And Pequot, I never can say this right, but Pequot Side Farms, is that correct? Pequot Side Farms. So we spent some time in there, and I was very cautious yesterday about talking about this because it wasn't my personal source, but we had been told that Karen may have driven back there. And I don't think that has turned out to be accurate. Because if it was, that video would still be included, but it's not. So I think that all that was picked, there are multiple cameras at that location. And I think all they picked up was a shot of Karen driving by. But there is like a 4 foot tall stone wall. So it really, one thing that we were able to determine there was that it would have got a really limited view of Karen's vehicle going by. And it would not have picked up anything about the condition of her taillight. So why were these things original? Why was that and Cassie's originally in discovery for the state? But since then, it's been dropped from what they will present at trial. Well, I think the obvious and only reason is because initially those were used to establish her travel route. Okay. Now remember, she fought surrendering her phone for like a year and a half. They had her phone, but she fought surrendering access to it. So they couldn't get into it. But eventually they did, and we haven't seen any reports on what they found. But they should have found GPS. They would have shown where she went. Now, there's other evidence that you could read in the motions in like December and January, both by the defense and the state, that don't say, but imply that her GPS was turned off when she went back out to look for John at 5 a.m. Because you can say that because if the GPS, for instance, the defense recently tried to say there's no evidence that Karen went back to 34 Fairview, whereas the state is implying that they have evidence that she did. Well, if her GPS was on, it would show whether she did or didn't definitively. And the defense did not come out and say, well, the GPS shows where she went and it didn't go to and she didn't go to 34. The defense didn't say that. All the defense, when you read it closely, all they said was that the state did not establish with their evidence where she went. And the state, when you look at their way they described it, they don't say that we have her GPS and it tracked her to 34. What they said was we have because she was using her phone during that journey, so probably making texts and calls. From that, they were able to, every time that happened, there was a record of communication with the cell tower. And so from that, they were able to track where she was going. So maybe they don't track her exactly to 34. We don't know. But they track her just going in that direction. How close they do, we don't know. But that's clear that the GPS was not on. And I've had other reports going back a long time that she did turn off her GPS. So the key thing to understand is if she turned off her GPS, when did she turn it off? If she turned it off a month before, well, then, then that's just and forgot to turn it back on. But I don't think turning off our GPS is something we normally do. I've never done it. I don't even know how to do it. I don't think putting your phone in airplane mode does it. So, but that's something we can research. So, just checking in with chat again to make sure. So, Tom does not appear to be up yet. So, or on board. So, yet. So, if somebody who has my number, if you see, because I'm looking at the document, I can't read. Actually, let me open this in a way. I can open this in a way where I can read it. But let me know if something comes on that you want me to go to live. So to me, there's indirect evidence that Karen turned off her GPS at some point after the accident. But we don't know that for sure. So I want to be careful about saying that. But also, the fact that some of these videos, Cassie's and Pequot's side, are no longer being used by the state, tells me they've managed to get through other means where her car traveled. Because there's also a GPS chip in the phone. I'm sorry, in her car. Modern cars like that come with a GPS. So whether or not they were able to extract that information, I don't know. All right, let's go back. So the chem team's vehicle diagram, the CERT team's unit diagram. So these are all stuff that go into this. There are multiple specialized teams that come in to gather the evidence. You have the CERT team that comes in at the scene and gathers all that evidence. You have the chem team at the garage testing everything. Oh, Tom is here. Thank you, Tom. Tom, text me if something comes on because I'm reading from a list. If you, I have Nesson on in NECN, not the sports Nesson. And if something comes live, I'll switch to it. I don't know if anything will come live today because you're still in the middle of the jury selection process, which is expected to take at least a week. They have managed to successfully seat 4 jurors. However, they will be seating 16, 4 alternate jurors. So there's no way that this is, and Friday is not a day that the jury reports, the prospective jurors report. So the trial is definitely not going to happen this week. Hopefully it will happen next week at some point, but looking like probably not till later in the week. They would have to succeed in seating 6 jurors today and 6 jurors tomorrow in order for the trial to start if that happened, I don't know if the trial would start Friday or Monday. But that seems unlikely. Busty says they'll finish on Thursday. Oh, well, if that's true, that would be great. But they managed to get four yesterday. So at that pace, they're not going to make it. However, they did have some motions and stuff to go over in the morning. So maybe that, you know, maybe they'll have a little bit more time today and tomorrow. They also had, there was some other work they had to do with the jurors, such as the judge addressing them at the beginning and stuff like that. So maybe they'll do a, maybe they'll manage to push through it. But it seems like typically on these cases, it can take up to a couple weeks to find jurors, because you have to find jurors that don't know any of the witnesses and that don't have strong opinions about this case, not to mention all kinds of other reasons that people try to get out of jury duty with. So we're getting the spinny thing over here on NECN. I don't know what that means. All right, they were switching to something else, but there's nothing live being shown on NECN. And somebody else actually reported today that local NBC affiliate Channel 7, I don't even know if Channel 7 is still NBC, but Channel 7 is going to be covering the case. Actually, I don't think Channel 7 is NBC anymore. I think they have their own, they're independent now, but they will be covering the trial. So, but there's really not much to cover today. So that's why and probably not for the next several days during this jury selection. So that's why I'm going down the evidence list. This was something I wanted to do last night, but still didn't quite feel good enough. Actually, I went to bed at like 7 o'clock. No, I know I'm an old dude. I don't usually go to bed at 7 o'clock. Usually it's more like 11:30. All right. So there's a copy of the Cellebrite extraction report of Kerry Roberts, of John O'Keefe, of Karen Reed. This is the first even mention I've seen of the Cellebrite extraction report for Karen, because it took so long and nobody's mentioned it in the motions. So the extraction from Jennifer McCabe, Kerry Roberts. Why is she, I don't know why she's listed twice. So there's one for Kerry. So the cell phone of Kerry Roberts from January 28th to the 29th. And I don't know why they would want her, anything from her from January 28th. I mean, she wasn't involved in any of this until she was called at 5 a.m. by Karen. She wasn't someone that was drinking at the bars, or she's not, she didn't even know Jen McCabe. She knew of her, but they didn't know each other. I don't know if she knew any of these people. Kerry Roberts was, she did live in Canton, but she had been someone who grew up with, or at least in, from going back to high school, was a close friend of John O'Keefe's in Braintree. And then so at some point she did move to Canton. Copy of Cellebrite extraction report of cell phone of John O'Keefe, phone calls from Karen. All right, so a lot of Cellebrite stuff here. Copy of the CARS report section. This is for the testing of the video. So the CARS unit is the unit from the Mass State Police that does all the vehicle testing to make, you know, I don't know if they're the ones that come up with the accident reconstruction report, but that's where it begins, because they start looking at the damage on the vehicle and all the other stuff within the vehicle to test it to make sure the brakes are working and all the sensors that and alarms and all that stuff. So the copy of OCME head and body and head diagrams, copy of CARS Bosch CDR download. So, you know, I can only guess on a lot of these things, but they would have had to get, does that include the download of the black box type data? And we hear black box, turns out to be way more complicated. It's not like this one little magic unit. There is a thing called a black box and it's inside the steering column, but there's information streams coming from multiple sensors on the car and they're being recorded at different locations too. Some of it goes to the entertainment center. So not sure what specifically all of these things are. Now, clothing, including the hat and the sneakers of John O'Keefe. The hat and one of the sneakers was found by the CERT team later on, digging in the snow. In addition, I should mention, a lot of people are making a big deal about a belt that is not listed. So is there a missing belt? And is that suspicious? This is something that Melanie Little, who seems to be a paid PR person for Karen, but that's something that they're seizing on. Well, I don't really see any importance of it because, first of all, I don't know that the belt is missing. Second of all, if the belt is missing, I don't see why it's a big deal. Now, I think the reason that they would say it's a big deal is, well, this shows that the evidence was not handled carefully. So it's a chain of evidence issue. But to me, if the belt is missing, and that's a big if, it's fairly simple. When they picked up John, he was clinging to life. Okay. And the job of the first responders was to keep him alive. And then there was the same thing at the ER. And as part of that, maybe as the most important part of that, they had to warm him up. His body temperature was down to 81 degrees. So you're doing all the different things to try to make sure his heart is pumping and to make sure he's getting oxygen and make sure he's breathing. But in addition, you need to start warming that body up. And we're going to find out there are very specific ways that ER teams do this because the human body can sometimes survive longer when it's subjected to sudden extreme cold. There are times where a kid falls through the ice and ends up Tom has to take his dog to the vet. So just want to say, Tom, don't worry, man. Thank you. And our dogs are going to the vet too at 11. So I will be off at that time. I may leave the show going if there's something going on interested on the stream, but otherwise we'll be off by 11 too. But thank you, Tom. So a kid falls through the ice at a pond, falls all the way to the bottom and is there for an hour at the bottom of a pond where obviously he's not breathing. But if the pond is extremely cold, there are numerous instances where that boy or girl survives, is brought to the surface. Eventually, when they dive down and bring him up, they bring him to the ER, they warm him up, and that person survives. And sometimes I've seen cases where not only survives, but without brain damage and is more or less fully recovered within hours. You know, they're back talking to their parents. So a lot of interesting things happen at low temperatures. In fact, there's been a lot of attempts over the last 10 years, I think particularly in Germany, to try to develop a way where if you have somebody that's severely incident at an auto crash scene, one way to keep that person alive until they can get him to the hospital is to kind of put his body into a deep freeze. So I don't know if they've ever actually developed that, because that would be very difficult to do, obviously, in those circumstances. But that's something that they've been experimenting with. So it's not impossible that John couldn't have been saved if his injuries weren't too severe. So while they're trying to save him, I'm just guessing that it's logical to start getting his clothes off. And so they may have taken his belt off on the ambulance. You're starting that process. Everybody's working at lightning speed as fast as they can to try to save this man's life. So does the belt get taken off and left on the ambulance and just nobody pays attention to it? It gets thrown out eventually. Then back at the emergency room, that clothing is taken off by doctors and ERs and staff at the emergency room in an emergency way. They're trying to hurriedly take this stuff off, and they're not at all thinking about evidence. They're thinking about saving this man's life. So is it possible that the way they threw the clothes into a corner or something like that, eventually that somehow the belt went missing? The belt would not have any significant evidence in any way for the defense or for the state. It just wouldn't be useful. And I think people are trying to bring this up because it's reported that John's clothing was filled with blood and vomit. And so they're trying to suggest that that must have happened inside the house. They left him lying in a pool of it or something like that. It's really absurd. And there's no evidence for it. So I guess the idea is if your belt is on, it must be harder for vomit and blood to get through the back of your pants, through, you know, the top part of your pants into your underwear. I mean, you know, it just seems that's a reach for me. That's a huge, huge, huge reach to the point of being, this is where the conspiracy theory has gone. They generally try to find thin little things like that to reach for because there's no other evidence. So. CLW says you have to be sitting for vomit to reach your pants. Well, you could also be lying. You know, if you're lying on the ground and the ground is frozen, then vomit will get into your pants. So will blood. So let's be careful about throwing around what is or what isn't common sense, because there's a lot of things that we might at first glance think are common sense, but really there are other ways. And we're all, and I don't mean that in an accusatory way, CLW, because there are things that struck me as common sense once upon a time in this case that turned out to be not at all. For instance, even though I live in a town similar in size to Canton, where, and I'm on a street that's similar in traffic to Fairview Road. In fact, my street is a little bit faster and a little more traveled than that one. I do now recognize that when the first responders or the fire department or the police, when they go down during the dark hours of morning or night to respond to a call, they do not have their sirens on. But I hadn't really thought about that. So back in the beginning, when we were told how nobody inside the house woke up and came outside, that this was a really powerful piece of evidence that they were, that there was some kind of a conspiracy, that it was really odd that they wouldn't do that. But then the answer was that they came in, that in Canton, just like any other small town, in those hours, there's no reason to put on the sirens and wake everybody up. So they don't. They just put on the lights. And so that's, so things started to come apart for me on that whole idea of the mystery of why Brian and his wife didn't wake up. And then as I started studying more about sleep and just thinking about it, I realized, no, it's not that surprising. So because we, all of us, tend to think of ourselves as light sleepers. Most of us do. We're not. We're much less of a light sleeper than we thought, than we think. Because if you think about it, when something wakes you up, so let's say it's something that's minor that wakes you up, somebody walking at the other end of your house, or something falling in another room, and you're saying, wow, I must be a light sleeper because that woke me up. Because you remember that. You remember the things that wake you up. But what you don't remember are the things that don't wake you up because you didn't wake up. So if a fire engine goes by with the sirens on and it doesn't wake you up, you don't say to yourself, wow, I'm a heavy sleeper because I didn't wake up to that fire engine. No, because you don't even know unless somebody else was around to tell you, wow, that fire engine didn't wake you up. So you don't know. So you have a distorted, we all have a distorted sense of our memory of this stuff. And the truth is that with all of us, there are times when we're sleeping, when we're sleeping lightly, and we're prone to waking up to a soft noise. There are other times that we sleep extremely heavily, and it's going to vary during the course of the night. So there might be an hour period early or an hour period later where you sleep really, really, you know, that's the kind of sleep you do when you're lying with your mouth wide open and maybe drooling or something like that or whatever. I mean, those are the kind of, when you're doing that kind of sleep, it's very hard to wake you up. And so one of the things that I was going to do a video on this once upon a time was on the number of weird true crime cases where you would think that people would wake up inside the house when the killer is in there. So for instance, the Amityville, this is the famous Amityville horror house, but before they tried to turn it into something supernatural, there was a real murder there where this 23-year-old son came into the house and with a single barrel shotgun, very loud weapon, killed his father, his mother, and his brother and his sister. Now the father and all of them were found lying on their stomachs. It was so odd that none of them woke up that the police initially speculated that they had been poisoned, that they'd been drugged. So that's why they slept. And then the autopsy showed that there was nothing in their system. So they just didn't wake up. And also none of the neighbors heard these shotgun blasts either. None of them. And the houses are pretty closely packed down in Amityville too. So, I mean, there are certain times in the night where people go into much deeper sleep than we imagine. And for me, the time that Brian and his wife were sleeping heavily there, that would be a time that I would be sleeping heavily too. So I might, for instance, 4 or 5 o'clock, you get up in the morning, you get up and you go to the bathroom, right? That's what happens when you get a little bit older. And then you go back to sleep. But that second sleep for me is always the deepest. It might only be an hour, you know, but that's so, like, let's say I go back to bed and initially maybe I don't go to sleep until 5:30, 6 o'clock even. I might only sleep from 6 to 7, but it's a really deep level of sleep. So anyways, what we think is common sense is not always common sense. Same thing with the belt and the throw up and the blood and stuff like that. So people likewise are always saying not a lot of blood was found on the scene. And I have no idea why they say that. I've probably asked that question to at least 100 people over the last 8-9 months that have said that. And nobody ever has an adequate answer for me. Why do you say there wasn't a lot of blood in the scene? Nobody ever seems to know the answer to that. I'm glancing a little bit at chat. So please, somebody, if there's something that goes live that you want me to link to, just let me know. In the meantime, I have it on NECN, which is going to go to court if there's anything that goes on. But if there's something else that goes on, you know, please let me know. All right. So as far as the blood, why do people think there was not a lot of blood there? They even reported that, I think, in the New York Post article and something else I saw recently, maybe in the Herald or the Globe. And I've never understood why they say that. Tom says, oh, crap. Uh-oh. What does that mean? What happened, Tom? You know, John's lying on the ground. He's outside. Even if the ground is frozen, the blood is still going to trickle into it, especially if it's warm, and be absorbed into the soil. If it's not completely level, it's going to roll downhill. It's going to absorb back into John's clothing. It's going to, same likewise with the vomit. And we also don't even know how much blood there would be, because the only spot John was bleeding from was his head. The blood was on top of what? I don't understand. John. So CLW says the blood was on top, but I don't know. The only thing I can think of is what he's talking about is the fact that there is blood splatter that was picked up in the snow, but that's from the impact wound. All right, that's from however the impact happened, blood sprayed into the snow, and those are the drops that they collected. And the only reason that they collected that blood and put it in those little red cups was because they thought it might belong to someone else. If they just assumed at that early morning time that this was a hit and run, they wouldn't have collected any blood. They would not have collected any blood, because why would you? What's the point? If you want a blood sample, you're going to have plenty of blood still inside the body. So the only reason they collected that blood was because they thought that maybe John was in a fight. And so those were cops that were diligently trying to do a good job. As it turns out, that's not the case. That blood was John's. So when people look at that and they say, because you only found some splatter on top of the snow, and they say, oh, well, that shows that's all the blood there was. So where's the rest of it? All the blood must be in the house. No, that's not the way it is. They would not have been collecting any blood that they found underneath John's body. Why would they do that? Because they would be assuming that that's John's blood. You don't normally collect blood at the scene. And I did look into this to make sure. I mean, even though it was common sense, but at a hit and run accident, so let's say some guy in the middle of Boston is hit on the street and they find him dead there, they don't go and collect the blood. Why would you? There's no reason to collect that blood, and they don't. The only reason that those Canton cops collected it is because they thought it might be someone else's. They had no interest in collecting any of John's blood. So there's no reason to actually think that there was any limit or lack of blood where John was found. Mark says you don't assume anything at all at a crime scene. No, that's not really true. Obviously, it's true to a point. But there are some assumptions you can make. All right. You can assume that this guy didn't die by machine gun bullets, right? You can look at, or you can even look at the wounds and say this guy wasn't shot, right? So you're not going to go around looking for bullet evidence. So, I mean, I just, you know, there are assumptions, there are just some common sense assumptions that you have to make. And I have confirmed with other police that no, you would not normally collect blood at a pedestrian accident. No way. And it's just common sense. Why would you? Why would you? So I'm guilty of it too. See, I used the common sense question there too. But I do think in this case, there is that. So there's no indication that there was a lack of blood at the crime scene. Just, you know, and we'll maybe see more about that when we get the full report from the CERT team. But by then, that was, you know, 15 hours later. How much of that was absorbed? How much of that, you know, it's, he wasn't lying on a floor. He was lying on the ground. So even though the ground is frozen, eventually this blood is going to be absorbed into the dirt. How much of his blood would come out? I think the human body holds 6 pints of blood, if I remember right. I think the human body holds 6 pints of blood, and that they estimate the head holds 2 pints of blood. So there, so that's the amount of blood. But if your heart is not pumping fully, you're not going to bleed. If your heart's not pumping, we don't know what the case was then. Also, the wound was not a bullet hole. It was a gash. So that was enough to create a little bit of blood. But I don't think it was the kind of wound that you'd get pints of blood pouring out of it. But we'll have to see. But there's really nothing suspicious here on the blood thing. And I don't know why it's constantly mentioned. I guess you're not accepting my explanation, CLW. Just because Court TV mentions something, this one of the I don't watch Court TV really very, very seldom because I'm very disappointed in Court TV. Because everything they do is extremely shallow. There's no analysis. Somebody comes on there that was a lawyer on some other case that knows nothing about this case and makes a really superficial comment. The blood you get, let's just say he got struck by the car. And I know the state has said that didn't happen, but however he got struck on the head. Actually, I think what the state said was the taillight did not strike his head. So it's possible some out of the other part of the vehicle struck his head. It's going to splash a little bit of blood. And that's what they picked up because they thought it might belong to the person that attacked him. So when you're saying I'm not giving you a reasonable explanation, I'm really kind of stunned because to me, it just seems like not only a reasonable one, it's the only and the most common sense and really, I don't really understand it, CLW. I mean, I think what happens sometimes is people cling to an idea in this case and they won't budge from it. And I guess that's human nature, but it is troubling. So I guess maybe if there's a few areas that I do well at, one of them is that I don't cling to an idea. So this is what got me into trouble with the Turtle Crowd, right? So all of these ideas this summer that I was weighing the evidence on, and basically all this was coming from Turtle Boy, and which meant it was coming from Karen. I weighed them all, and now some of the ideas that I had crazy ideas about data. I thought the black box data would just be an upload, you know, and something that they could then download and read. It turns out to be much more complicated. I assumed that the black box would have a timestamp data on it, but it doesn't. Or typically doesn't. I don't know about this case. So I had a lot of naive ideas. And that, like I already said, about why that Brian and his wife didn't wake up. But I didn't cling to them. You keep asking questions and seeing if there is a better explanation. Now, this is one of those ones where, to me, the explanation for the blood is pretty simple. It's very simple. And we also know that the defense got permission to have their experts go in the house this summer and search for blood. And they didn't find any. So that's something I had confirmed from sources on that side. It's reported the FBI went in too. I don't actually know that. And that hasn't been listed in any documents or said. Of course, it wouldn't be said by Unity or Jackson in court because He's not going to say, yes, the FBI went in and they found nothing. He's only going to say things that help them. So to me, the blood thing is just a non, it's a non-issue. And I don't know, I don't really think it's difficult to understand why they collected a few drops of blood that were on the top of the snow. I don't think it's difficult to understand how that blood got there when from the impact, however that happened. And I also don't think there's any evidence that there was a lack of blood at the scene. There's no evidence for that. We haven't even seen pictures of the ground. There was some pictures before that went out early in this case, but when you look at it closely, it doesn't actually look like where they found John. It looks like the curbstone. So I don't know. Well, we will see more accurate pictures on this, but to me, it's not unusual that blood absorbs into the clothing and into the ground. There's nothing unusual about that. That's just how it works. So Keith Allen, ironically, goes to Caps, saying no one with a brain, but he's obviously one of the zombies. You know, that's there's no shortage of them. I like this song, sorry. Sorry, I had to have a little fun with that, but this is where you get the zombies coming in. You get somebody that's a turtle rider that has no concept of evidence and not really is even interested in this. But that was, what was that girl's name? Dolores O'Riordan or something like that. That was kind of a sad, tragic case. She's someone that was incredibly talented and seems to have been and was found stardom relatively early, like in her early 20s, became a hit. And over time, stardom went to her head, and she became a drug addict and had all kinds of issues, and she died very young, which is really a shame because she did seem to be a very special talent, you know, from Ireland. But that was her first big hit song, I think, and that was that. Maybe that was part of the problem too. Maybe after her first album, there was nothing. That happens a lot of times. People have their first album has some hits on it, and then that's it. They can't find anything else. But anyways, I like that song. But yeah, there are some zombies in this case. And this dude up there is, I already forgot his name, but he's one of them. I mean, I'm not talking about you, CLC. I'm talking about the guy who came screaming in with Caps. Keith Allen. Sign off, clown, and stop being a moron. No one with a brain believes Karen did this. You know, I'm going to just keep analyzing evidence objectively. And that's probably not something that Keith is capable of. But there's all kinds of issues that get in a way with people when they try to consider this case. There's emotional issues. If for some emotional reason you believe Karen is innocent, that has to do with maybe you don't like cops because you were arrested when you were 18, or maybe you believe the system is rigged against you because life hasn't been as fortunate to you. Maybe you just have bought into conspiracy theories. There's all kinds of reasons. And in some cases, but you know, I'm not saying that people can't have doubts. And you know, there's parts of this case that I don't like either. So, but for people that just, they've come in screaming like that and they say, there is no doubt, Karen, it is, and you're a moron. It's just, there's nothing screams moron than like that kind of screaming. But all right. So let's get back to some of the evidence then. So just to sum up, I don't think that there's any sign that there was any missing blood. And there's no basis for saying that at all. All right. So Copy of cell phone extraction. Oh, this isn't. Oh, or this must have been. All right. So copy of cell phone extraction of communications of Brian Higgins. But some comment needs to be done on this. So it looks like Brian, this must be from not the phone that he was using at that time. Remember, there was third party order, or there was a decision by the judge to get some of these third party phones. So Brian Higgins, Brian Albert, there was Kevin Albert rather, and there was a fourth one. Maybe Chief Berkowitz, I think. Now Brian Higgins, however, had by then already destroyed his phone and got a new phone under a new carrier. So a lot of suspicious activity on the surface by Brian Higgins. And this is where it requires people to really, really weigh evidence in a finely here. Okay. Just because somebody does something suspicious does not mean they are connected to a crime. And it certainly does not mean they're connected to a crime in this case. So let's just say, in theory, Brian Higgins was part of a crew of bank robbers, and there's evidence of that in his phone. Now, obviously, I'm making that up. That's fiction. Brian Higgins is an ATF agent. But let's just say that in his phone, the week before this happened, he and a couple other guys robbed a bank. And there's evidence of that in the communications. Well, he doesn't want the government to have those communications. Now, I'm sure that's an absurd example, but there could be things in his phone that he doesn't want people to see. Okay, Tom is heading out. Anyway, sorry, I was just checking the message. So there are things on a lot of people's phones, maybe even the majority of people's phones, certainly guys in their 20s, 30s, 40s, you know, the guys that like to go out, drink and party like Brian Higgins did. There's going to be embarrassing things on his phones, things that could even jeopardize his career, right? You could even have an off-color message that, taken out of context, might look in a way that could damage his career. So there's a lot of reasons that would have nothing to do with the murder of John O'Keefe that could potentially be the explanation for why he would want to destroy his phone. But so what happened afterwards is after Brian Higgins found out what happened, he went to a friend who works for the federal government in data, and had that friend take an extraction of all of his communications with John and with Karen, and only with those two. Now, Higgins was given a subpoena by Michael Proctor to turn over his phone, but he did not do it. He ignored that subpoena. So there could be problems there, right? Instead, what he handed over was that listing. And we don't know we'll never know what was on the other communications. Now, I think we can say that there's no chance that he deleted any communications between himself and John or himself and Karen, because that would show, because the state has all of Karen's and all of John's communications. So he could not have deleted any of those, but there obviously was other stuff on the phone that he didn't want anyone to see. Were the feds able to recover any of that? I don't know, but my guess is they probably couldn't recover specific communications, like what was in the message. However, they probably could have got from the phone companies where and when calls and text messages were sent. So if he sent five text messages between, you know, say 6 and 8 o'clock to Brian Albert, they would have a listing of that, I think. They wouldn't have any information about what was in those communications, but they would have those specific messages, just like they know that there was a couple of, there was so Brian Albert butt dialed or something similar to that, accidentally called John, I'm sorry, Brian at what time was it? I think sometime after 2, so I don't know, 2:10 or 2:15, I forget the exact time, 2 a.m., that there was a call, and then so Higgins didn't accept that call because he was probably sleeping or whatever. But when he got up and he grabbed the phone, saw who it was, he called back And that call connected, but only for 22 seconds. So the feds were able to determine that, but we have no idea if there was any speaking during that call, certainly what was said. So all we know is that there was a 22-second connection. And for all I know, that might have, that 22 seconds could be voicemail. Because that it seems to me, I don't know this, so people can correct me, but it seems to me I've seen this before, that a lot of these call connect, that shows as a connection and it's really just going to voicemail, that seems to usually be about 22 seconds or 27 seconds or something like that. So I don't know. So there's the stuff on Higgins. Copy of Verizon Volte records of cell sites diagrams for Karen Reed's phone. I have no idea what that means, but it's information that came from Verizon about Karen's phone. Copy of Verizon RTT records of diagrams. So that's of Karen's phone. Another thing like that, I have no idea what it is. Copy of certified copy of medical records of John at the hospital. Copy of Karen's medical records. Copy of Canton Police Department cruiser camera videos. So this is the one that emerged recently and it's big. Well, actually, I'm sorry. There would have been this cruiser camera video of the scene at 34 when they responded with Karen and Jen and Kerry out with John in the snow. But now the most recent copy is of the squad car that was sent to John's house to check on the niece at 8:22. It pulled up right behind Karen's SUV where it had been left there. So it got apparently a very clear video images of the condition of that taillight. And I'm told by multiple sources that it's clear that it's missing pieces and it's more or less what you see later. So if it turns out to be that those images are crystal clear and they look more or less like the condition of the taillight as it was later on, well, then there's no reason to even discuss anything that happened in the garage. There's no reason really. Because if the taillight is damaged in that way that we found it later, if it's already damaged like that at 8:22, nothing else as far as the garage or tampering matters. If the taillight was like that at 8:22, then if there was any tampering with that taillight, it had to occur before 8:22. And in addition to that, as I've shown many times on this channel, at 5 o'clock when Karen left, now that video is not going to be as clear because it's at night, but that seems to show clearly that there are missing pieces and they are more or less in the same pattern of what is found later. So we got Canton Police Department scene search video. So they must have had video after John was taken away. Maybe I don't know if there's someone pull out a camcorder. I don't know what that is. Or if it's just coming from, it doesn't say dash cam, so I don't know. Copy of John O'Keefe's GPS points. And those are the ones that show. His phone did not go in the house. Copies of the Mass State Police lab work. Copy of the Mass State Police cars section, Toyota tech screen, ACM and VCH data. So this has to do with the electronic vehicle data. And as I said, there are a lot of, it's complicated when it comes to that data. There are more than one recording and format. It's difficult to extract that data. And there's also, just checking a message. Just gonna open this up here a little bit more. All right. So there's more. It's difficult to get that, and there's multiple sensor streams coming in. Canton Police Department surveillance video. So that would be of the garage. Video of the residence in Dighton. It doesn't say where that's from. Now, where the can't. Oh, so that would be. I'm sorry. That would be. So the troopers. It was troopers Proctor and Buchanan that went to Dighton, and the troopers do have body cams. So there would be video of them going in to talk to Karen with her family there. The taillight from the defendant's vehicle. So this is why the taillight was removed. It's just standard procedure in the case. It's not unusual. And you noticed that automotive owner and then CPD cop is not on the list. His name is Brian Wanless, and he is not on the list for the defense. Now, my information from a ways back was that Wanless did help the state police chem team remove the taillight that they were having a difficult time with, but it's all documented. And so there's nothing, and it was all with the chem team was there with him when they did it. So there's nothing unusual or suspicious about it. And that's, and if there was something unusual about it, then you would see Wanless as a defense witness. So this was a huge part of Sean's claim to support that. This was really, for many ways, the only part of Sean's claim for a long time that there was a conspiracy going back to the summer. This comes from the odd fellow there, Peter Murphy, who can Google Josh Levy's number, U.S. attorney, and it just comes right up and he calls him and the U.S. attorney answers the phone. Anyways, that was his thing. Now, so Murphy, this is what happens in these cases. People insert themselves. They want to be a player. It just draws them in for people that maybe don't have something going on in their lives or they miss law enforcement or whatever. So in every big case like that, there's going to be people that not everybody feels that pull, but a certain percentage of the public feels that pull. And it's very powerful to get drawn into the case. Just like at Cassie's when that woman sent the surveillance video for me and Dave and his son visiting her store a couple of days ago. So, I mean, people want to be, they want to be a player. They want to get involved. So Murphy had been retired for 12 years and he inserts himself into this case and he starts going around and talking to guys that he used to work with. And one of the guys he talks to, he visits at his shop, is his auto body shop, is Brian Wanless. And Brian Wanless must have admitted, yeah, I helped them take off the taillight. But then that's it. Brian Wallace didn't say anything else. But again, it's just not a useful piece of, it's not evidence of a cover-up. It's not evidence of anything. Except that maybe the state police chem team didn't have the right tool that day to take off a Lexus taillight. And so they went to someone they happen to have on hand that was an auto body expert. Maybe that's a comment on that the state police chem team needs a little bit more training. I don't know. Maybe that's an indication that the state police cars team, which can take apart cars and put them back together, that they hadn't arrived yet. You know, we don't know. But it was someone on the chem team that wanted that taken off. And there's nothing suspicious about it. So, and if you think there was, you can get rid of that idea because Wanless is not just reading the comments, but Wanless is not on the defense witness list. We'll get to that more in a moment. Well, we'll go down the list, but I won't repeat anything about. All right, so here's getting to the witness list. So all, the last of the evidence pieces. So taillight pieces recovered from the scene, cocktail glass recovered from the scene, and the victim's cell phone. Thus ends the list. So here is the Commonwealth's witness list. Michael Proctor, Yuri Bukenik, Trooper Zachary Clark, Trooper Connor Keefe, Trooper David Tachico, Trooper Christopher Moore. That guy, there's a Christopher Moore that writes a bunch of satire books. Some of them are kind of funny. Christopher Moore, pretty famous writer. Obviously not the same guy, but you guys might have heard of that Christopher Moore. Christopher Moore. Trooper Matthew Dunn, Lieutenant Brian Tully, Trooper Nicholas Guarino. That's the state police's forensic guy, forensic data guy, sorry. Trooper Joseph Paul, Officer Stephen Seraph, Officer Stephen Mullaney. Sergeant Sean Good of the Canton Police Department, Michael Link, Canton Police, Paul Gallagher, who's a lieutenant, Canton Police, Charles Ray, Kevin O'Hara of the Mass State Police, Nicholas Barrows, Dighton Police Department. So remember, there was an officer. So Michael Proctor, on his way to Dighton, called ahead to the Dighton police and had the cop, the Dighton police, send someone there. So a Dighton patrol officer went there first. Now, that's not what you would do if your mission was to tamper with the vehicle. You would not call the Dighton police, not until you had a chance to get there and decide what action you were going to take. If you already knew that your action was to steal taillight pieces, again, you would wait till you do that. And then you call the Dighton police and say, oh, by the way, can you send someone here? Can you send a tow truck? Can you send a plow? Those kind of things. So it's just, all of this is yet more evidence that there was no kind of conspiracy going on, no consciousness of guilt. Sergeant Brian Gallerani of the Needham Police Department. I don't know what that's involved. Trooper Evan Brent of the State Police. Trooper Everton DeCastro of the State Police. Trooper Justin Pye of the Mass State Police. And Captain Eric Benson. All right, the defense witnesses. This is where it gets... Oh, I'm sorry, before I get that. Then there were some civilian witnesses. No, I'm sorry, I'm not on the defense yet. I'm just going down this list. That's a mistake. So, all right, civilian witnesses. This is how the state broke it down. Heather Maxson of Plainville. Anthony Fianetti of the Canton Fire Department. Dr. Irene Scordibello. That's the chief medical examiner. Dr. Renee Stonebridge, office of the chief medical examiner. So this confirms I'd always been told that there were two medical examiners that did the examination. So two are going to testify. So you're going to have two medical examiners tell us that John was not in a fight. So if you believe there's a conspiracy, you have to believe that the McAlberts got to both medical examiners and got them to play ball. And these are doctors. Timothy Nuttall of the Canton Fire Department, Francis Walsh, Canton Fire Department, Matthew Kelly, Gregory Woodbury, Katie McLaughlin, all Canton Fire Department. Jason, Katie McLaughlin is the one that was originally in the charging document talking about Karen saying, I could have done this, or I did this, or I hit him, or something to that effect. So, and then we now know all these guys are going to testify to something similar. And looks like there's like seven or eight. Jennifer McCabe, Matthew McCabe, Allie McCabe, that's their daughter. Kerry Roberts, Kurt Roberts. Not sure what he would be testifying to, but maybe what time, I don't know. Who knows? Paul O'Keefe, that's John's brother. And John was at the house when Karen came home. So he's probably going to testify about Karen's actions at that time. Now, we're told that Karen and her father went up into the room where the computer was, and that may be where the Ring video was deleted. We don't know. That's all speculative. Then the nephew and niece, Michael Camerano, Catherine Camerano, I think they were drinking with them at the waterfall. Brian Higgins, Brian Albert, Nicole Albert, Brian Albert Jr. Brian Albert Jr. really was not a witness to anything except that he was inside the house. So the way the party was aspect, this was confusing to people too, is that there were basically two parties there, although the second one is not really a party. And I don't think the first one sounds like it was a big party, but it was Brian Albert Jr.'s birthday party. It was his birthday. So there were people over the house for that. And separate to that, Brian Sr. had been out with everybody at the waterfall. So Brian Sr., his wife, Brian Higgins, Chris Albert, Karen and John eventually, I'm not sure who else. But so the after hours was just those guys saying, hey, let's go have a drink at the house. This is because the bar was closing. So they were invited back to 34. But Brian Jr.'s party was ending and all of the guests from there were leaving. And that included, now some of the guests stayed. So for instance, Julie Nagel would have been a guest at that party, but stayed. Colin Albert left, and he was gone at least 5 or 6 minutes before John and Karen. I'm sorry. Yeah, John and Karen could have arrived there. They arrived around 12:24, 12:25. So what is the evidence for that? Well, we're going to find that the data will show, for instance, the two things. Allie texted Colin when Allie McCabe was picking him up. She texted him, I think it was as soon as 12:10. I'm not 100%. I forget on that. So Colin would have come out. So how do we know that he came out? What time did they leave? Well, then there's an app, Lifetime 360, that you can use to track your kids. And that app was still active on Allie's phone. And so they were able to track her going home. So to posit that Colin was still there, you would have to go with the idea that that he came out and said, all right, I'm staying, go ahead. And then they would, you know, so that you could probably track her phone and see that she went to the Alberts to drop off, to Chris Alberts to drop off the son. Now, I've never heard any evidence on that, but I'm assuming that that's easy to do. And I do know that they have that Life 63 app. So I'm sure you're going to be able to see that. So the data is going to show. So you would have to assume that Colin didn't get in the car. And then for some reason, Allie still drove by Chris Albert's house. Doesn't make sense. Also on the list is Ian Whiffen from Canada. Remember the good old days of a couple months ago when all the free Karen Reed zombies were somehow convincing themselves that Ian Whiffen, a prosecution expert, was going to really testify for the defense? Just madness. Even Olivia posting stuff like that all the time. It's just the madness of this case that people fall for those stunts. Olivia knows better. She's not stupid. But she knows the zombies are stupid. And so she puts stuff out there like that. Dr. Justin Rice. This is one of the ER doctors. Nurse practitioner, Daisy Osmond. Kathleen Wilfred, another nurse from Good Samaritan. Kathleen, medical director. So this would have been an all hands on deck. Somebody coming in a life, real, you know, needing to be his edge, clinging on the precipice to try to get everybody to save this guy's life. And there may have been some more effort knowing that it was a cop. I don't know. But I don't think so. I think the idea is to try to save everybody. This is interesting. Terry Kuhn of the UC Davis Veterinary Lab. Okay. There's no one from a veterinary lab on the defense list. So this is someone, and we looked it up. This is one of the most elite veterinary labs and doctors, veterinary doctors that you can find. So this person is going to testify that the wounds on John's arm were not caused from a dog attack or an animal attack. I mean, so I don't really understand why people still even believe that's possible, because the DNA test showed that there was no canine material found on John's clothing, which it absolutely would be if he was attacked by a dog. But if you for some reason want to dismiss that with some kind of weird idea that Michael Proctor carried around John's clothes in his trunk for a month and at some point washed them, and there's no evidence of that. I mean, it's just, if you still believe that, this doctor is going to come in and testify. But that's no. This was interesting too. This next one, Nicholas Bradford from Bodie Technology and Tess Chart from Bodie Technology. So I have not seen, and I don't know if any of you guys have, and you can tell me, I have not seen the ruling on whether to allow the DNA testing from Bodie Technology. This was due to be ready literally yesterday. To me, I've thought that because of this, that there's a chance. I always thought there'd be a better than 50-50 chance that the judge would not allow this. Now, does this mean that the judge has allowed this technology? Maybe, maybe not, because it might just mean that those two experts are going to come in and testify that it was a human hair, because they did certainly complete that part of it. We know from what Lally said, and again, with any testing or any exhibit or any piece of evidence, you can't take anybody's word for it, including Lally. But he has said that he said at the last hearing that there was a match between John's DNA and that hair, the DNA found in that hair. So will that be allowed? I don't know. But definitely they're gonna come in and say that it was a human hair. And again, just remember Turtle Boy and Alan Jackson trying to scream that it's a non-human hair. Just remember that. When you think, people have to question what they're told by all sides, really. But certainly by the defense team, certainly by Turtle Boy. And oh my God, if Sean or Tom CPU or the Grifter or Jellyfish, if those guys tell you something, it's almost certainly not true. Sean's batting record is zero. I've never seen anything like it. Everything he puts out is false. It's incredible. All right, on the list, Julie Albert, Christopher Albert, Colin Albert, Ryan Nagel, Tristan Morris, don't even know who that is, Caitlin Albert, that's the daughter, Gretchen Voss of Boston Magazine. Gretchen Voss had interviewed Karen extensively, and we're going to find out that Karen and Yannetti screwed up. So this was entered in discovery only in January, but Gretchen Voss had talked to people and played the audio for people that I've talked to. So Karen said, people that I trust, by the way. So Karen said in this interview with David Yannetti present that the Mass State Police lied about not finding any pieces of taillight inside John's driveway or at John's driveway. And the reason she knew they lied was because she herself, when she examined her taillight, had pulled a piece out and dropped it on the driveway. Obviously, when she was doing that interview last summer, she didn't understand, and Yannetti didn't understand the importance of what they were saying, or they wouldn't have allowed her to say it. Because she describes in vivid detail just how broken that taillight was. And no, it was not just cracked. There were pieces missing and wires showing, the way she said it, to the point where she even says she was worried about the operation of the vehicle. That's kind of crazy, but that's what she thought. All right. So, in her own words, Karen destroys everything that Sean McDonough has been saying for almost a year. Destroys it in her own words. And you're going to hear that in court. You're going to hear it. Now, for a zombie, it doesn't matter what you hear because you've already made up your mind and you're not going to actually listen to evidence because this is an emotional issue. But to everybody else, it's going to be extremely powerful. Louis Jutras of Can, Nicholas Roberts of the Massachusetts Office of Alcohol Testing. So they're going to talk about Karen's blood level, or her blood alcohol level, I assume. That part of the case has never been that interesting to me, but you know, Karen's degree of intoxication. She's not being charged with a DUI here, so I don't know. It doesn't really tell me anything about what happened. Sarah Levinson was in the house. She's going to testify. Audrey Porto of the Mass State Police Crime Lab. Ashley Viller of the Crime Lab. Maureen Hartnett of the Crime Lab. Christine Hanley of the Crime Lab. Sophie Crisen of the Crime Lab. Lucky Loughran of Canton is on the defense list. I'm sorry, this is on the prosecution list. Yeah, so Lucky Loughran, the plow driver, is on the prosecution list. What does that tell you? What is he going to testify for them? Well, I think what he's going to testify is that he plowed the street. Now, of course, just because somebody's on the list doesn't mean that either side has to call on him. But it's important to know that the street was plowed, because that's why the larger pieces of taillight, the two pieces that the CERT team found sometime around 5:45, those pieces were buried deep in the snow. Now, there was much more snow at that time than there was at between, say, like 6 and 8, 6 and 9, whenever the Canton police were looking around out there. But at that time, sorry, I was just looking at the message. But at that time, it had been snowed. And if you look at the dash cam photo that was leaked from Karen through Sean about a month ago, you can see the size of the plow mound that was there. So let's say maybe 2 inches of snow had fallen at the time that Lucky first plowed that location. So sometime maybe around 5:30 or something. Now, this is just my eyeballing of it, but it looks to me like it's about 16 inches wide by 16 inches high. So not some deep mound. You wouldn't want to build a snow fort in that, but certainly deep enough for pieces of taillight, say about this big, to be wrapped up in it. And so the taillight would have exploded when the car made impact, and it, those taillight pieces would be on the street, and then they would get plowed up. And there's no way the Canton police were ever going to bring a shovel to a state police crime scene. And that's that crime scene was automatically going to be turned over to the state police, because in the town of Canton, in every town in Massachusetts, with the exception of Springfield, Worcester, and Boston, who are large cities and they have their own homicide departments, in every other town in Massachusetts, when there's any kind of a suspicious death, it automatically, the investigation is taken over by the state police, automatically. Just yet another distortion by Jackson and Yannetti on that. They made it seem like the Canton police took them off because Kevin Albert was on the Canton police force. No, it was automatic. Richard D'Antonio of Canton, Jen DeMillis, James Sullivan, Stephen Bernstein. Just going through all these guys. I don't have to read them all because they're not really relevant to anything. Jessica Hyde of Bridgeport, New York. This is obviously a forensic. This is one of the most elite forensic data experts in the world. And she's going to testify that the alleged 227 search for how long to die in the cold actually took place at 6:23. So she is among the best of the best. And you can see her website on that. But you can see it. Rich Green is a nobody. Can't find anything on him. We never could find anything on Rich Green. He's a guy in his 70s who started doing this in his 50s. And that's not to in any way impugn on his capability. You have to understand what his job is. His job is to find something that helps the defense. That's how he's going to get hired in other trials. The defense team, when they hire someone like that, just like when they hire a medical expert, when they hire someone, they know the guys that they can bring in that are going to try to find things that are helpful to them. And the guys that are doing this work know it too. And that's how they make a living. Doesn't mean they're lying. I'm not accusing Rich Green of lying, and I don't think he's lying. What it means is he's going to search through and try to find something that will help the defense. He's not trying to get to the truth. He's not trying to do some deeper analysis. As soon as he finds something that will help the defense, some kind of a report that comes out of the software, full stop, he stops his work, because you don't want to risk doing anything, finding anything that would not support that conclusion, and send that off to the defense team. His job is done. And so the 2023 version of Cellebrite came out with that timestamp. The 2022 version did not, which is more accurate. This is when you have to dig in deeper to all the other surrounding stuff that's going on inside the phone. It's not something that you and I can do. It's something that you have to be an active, high-level forensic data specialist to do this stuff, if you know, to be on top of that. All right, so let's get to the defendants. This is the witness list of the defense. Brian Albert, Caitlin Albert, Christopher Albert, Colin Albert, Julie Albert, Kevin Albert, Nicole Albert, Michael Wagner. Don't know who that is. It says of Foxborough. Cheryl Waugh, Paul Makowski. That's the private investigator that Yannetti employed on this case. Leslie Bernstein, Rebecca Bazin. Officer Nicholas Barros of the Dighton Police Department. Officer Paul Bedon, it's a French name. I'm not pronouncing it right. Also of the Dighton Police Department. Former Chief of Canton Police, Ken Berkowitz. Berkey. Trooper Evan Brent of Buchanan. Lori Cahill of Worcester, Mass., where I spent about 20 years of my life. But I don't know Lori. I don't know what her relevance is here, if she's some kind of an expert or whatever. Trooper Zachary Clark, Christopher Curran of Canton, Kerry Curran, Nicholas Curran, Richard D'Antonio, Officer, all right, so this is an interesting, this one is very interesting. Officer Kelly Dever of the Boston Police Department. Why would a Boston Police Department officer be relevant here? Well, what I'm told is that Officer Kelly Dever was actually, at the time, an officer for the Canton Police Department. So what did she witness? Well, she's witnessed something that the defense wants to bring in. So I'm not going to speculate on that today, but Officer Kelly Dever seems to be an interesting name. Was she one of the responding officers? I haven't heard that name before for that. So I don't think that at least the prosecution hasn't listed her that way. Was she the officer that was sent to the home on One Meadows? Maybe. Was she in the garage when they towed Karen's SUV there? Did she witness anything? I don't know. Maybe. Stephanie Devlin of the Massachusetts State Police Crime Lab. Trooper David DeChico, Mass State Police. Patrick Haggerty of Dighton, Mass. So that's the, it doesn't say Dighton Police, so I don't know. Does that, would that be a neighbor? That might be a neighbor, I guess. I'm just guessing. I don't really know. That could be a neighbor. So maybe some Ring video was picked up. Maureen Hartnett, Mass State Police. Brian Albert Jr., Brian Higgins. Louis Jutras of Canton, Mass. Trooper Connor Keefe, Matthew Cully of the Kelly of the Canton Fire Department. Oh, they do. So they do have a. Oh, I'm sorry. They have the same veterinary lab witness on here. So, Dr. Terry Kuhn of the USC, the UC Davis Veterinary Lab. So they have the same witness on here. So I guess the question would be: is who is bringing in this witness first? So I guess I'll backtrack from what I said just a little while ago. It's possible that this is the defense team's primary witness. So I don't know. We'll see. But it's interesting that that witness is on there for both. I've never, you know, the thing is I'm going to say it's probably the prosecution for this reason, because last week and in other times when Lally has talked about their witness, that their supposed expert medical witness that shows that that was the result of a dog attack, it's somebody else. I think the name was Sheridan. We'll come up to that, I think, in a moment. But they never mentioned that guy. So I think that might be the prosecution's witness. But interestingly, the defense has him up here, too. So Lucky Laughlin is on the defense list. Heather Maxson of Plainville. Allie McCabe, Jer McCabe, Matt McCabe. Lance Mello of the Crime Lab. Ryan Nagel. Steve Nelson of the DA's office, Andrew Porto of the Crime Lab, Trooper Kathleen Price, Elizabeth Proctor is on the defense witness list, Trooper Michael Proctor, Kerry Roberts, Wendell Robry, they got all the fire guys here. This is the one I don't know. This is another Boston Police Department witness. Heriberto, it's not spelled as Herberto, maybe it's misspelled, but Heriberto Hernandez. That could be a misspelling. Maybe it's Herberto. I would think it's Herberto. Herberto Hernandez of the Boston Police Department. Mark Lopilato, Alfred Lopilato. Those are going to testify if they are brought in about the fight 20 or 25 years ago that Chris Albert was in at a bar, and supposedly then Officer Lank, I think he's now a sergeant, but back then would have been just an officer, but that he responded, and there was a whole lawsuit centered on that case and stuff like that. And, you know, all I have is the documents submitted by the defense. And if those documents are true, I mean, certainly Lank's behavior back then was very suspect. But again, you're only seeing the defense side of those documents. So who knows? Brian Tully, Courtney Proctor, Kristen Morris, Gene DeMolis, Ashley Bell, interesting. I don't know what she's actually a witness to, but she's someone that allegedly became a close confidant of Turtle Boy over the summer, to put it delicately. Mike Rushworth of Tennessee. So, see, the defense does not break down who their witnesses are, whether they're experts or outside experts or something. So the fact that Mike Rushworth is from Tennessee tells me it must be some kind of expert that they're bringing in, but no idea what. The defense says DA Michael Morrissey on their list. Thomas Beatty of Canton. Now, Thomas and Thomas Beatty's daughter, Erin. So Thomas Beatty, in some ways, seems to have been the beginning of the third party culprit. In the days after, Yannetti hired a private eye. I mentioned his name above. And this private eye was going around the homes in the area and trying to get information, and spoke with this Thomas Beatty, who was, I guess, supposed to be friends with both Karen and John. And it was, if nothing else, it was Tom that told this private investigator that Colin had been in the house. So, short time after that, Brian Scanlon, who's also a private investigator, maybe looking to get work in this case, or maybe just wanted to insert himself into it for some reason, but someone who had no evidence of anything, met with Yannetti. He reached out to Karen online initially, and she said, contact my lawyer. So he met with Yannetti, and he has sworn now. He has tested that he had no evidence of anything. So that, and that's all been listed in public documents. And Scanlon is not on the defense witness list. So he has nothing. Scanlon had nothing. He's just someone that was a private investigator and wanted to get involved and help out the defense team. But when he was in the office with Yannetti and with the private investigator they were employing, that's when he first heard of Colin, because it was Yannetti who actually talked about Colin and started floating the idea of Colin being a suspect at that point. But Steve Scanlon didn't know anything about that. Sorry, I call everybody Brian because half the people in this case are Brian. So you could see they were already trying to build that theory. Now, what was it based on? Well, I think initially Brian Albert Sr. did not tell the Canton police that Colin was there with them in the house. Well, the reason was because he wasn't. He had left, and he only saw Brian in passing in the driveway. Colin was leaving. Brian was just getting home from the waterfall. So he just didn't really think it was relevant to put him on the list. But eventually, it was admitted that he had been in the house at some point. So, is Thomas Beatty, did he really suspect something happened? Did he have his own axe to grind? You know, we don't know. I've heard a lot of different things there. Erin Beatty is actually was a close friend of Colin Albert's. In fact, in the video where I think it was Colin and Chris and Erin to kind of play a prank on John, they went into, when John was away with Karen on vacation, I don't know if that was the Aruba vacation or if it was something else, but they went outside the ring and just kind of clowned around in front of the camera so John would see it. And the defense wants to interpret that in one way. I wasn't there. Who really knows? You could read into it a little bit. All right. So the defense is going to look at that and say, aha, this shows that Chris and Colin and Erin Beatty were fucking with John. Excuse my language, but that's what they were doing, because they knew that John was a little bit OCD when it came to neatness, and he didn't like anybody on his lawn. So they were showing him that. So there was a way of them basically taunting. That's what the defense is going to say. And what Chris Albert would say is that, no, we were friends and I was just messing around. We were just, because we knew he was on vacation. What is the truth? Well, this is why you have to weigh all of the evidence to get context. The day John died, that afternoon, he took his nephew, I forget, maybe 9 or 10 years old. He took his, at the time, took his nephew out for pizza. Where did he go? He went to D&E Pizza, Chris's pizza place. Now, I can tell you, I was in Canton 3 days ago, 2 days ago, 2 days ago. And there's a pizza place in the plaza right across the street next to the Walgreens. So me and Dave McGrath and his son went in there for a slice. We didn't go into D&E Pizza, not because the pizza was bad or anything. We hear the food is excellent there, especially the chicken palms. And I'll hopefully visit there after this case is over. But I didn't think it would look good because I'm covering this case to go in there. And I also, these poor people have suffered from a circus. And so if anybody saw me and Dave walking in there, it just might have brought down more heat onto his business. There could have been people, a crowd might have formed. Who the hell knows out there? So we just thought it was best to avoid that. But so if John just wanted a slice of pizza or a whole pizza, whatever, they could have gone to that place in the plaza across the street. I'm sure there's other pizza places in town too. But they didn't. They went to D&E Pizza. And the reason is because John and Chris were friends. Kevin Albert, who's a detective on the Canton Police Force, is an even closer friend of John's. John did not really know Brian very well, Brian, although they were both Boston police officers. Boston's a big police department, though. So Chris is a friendly guy, and he came over and was talking to him, and he invited John out for drinks because he knew they'd all be meeting at the waterfall later. So that's how this came about. But even so, then later that night, John was actually at CJ McCarthy's, which is very close to the waterfall. We didn't go in, but we took some pictures. Actually, CJ McCarthy's is right next to D&E Pizza. And they took some, John and his friend, Karen was not drinking with them. Karen was not part of it at that time. John was drinking there with his friend. And Chris texted him at some point, hey, now we're here at the waterfall. Come on over if you want to hang out with us. Now, by then, Karen had joined them. So what had happened was Karen was not originally part of the plan to go out. My reports that Karen was very jealous. John was a friendly kind of guy, and Karen was very jealous. So those two things can lead to friction, right? As we saw from the Aruba trip. So Karen texted John, do you mind if I come down? So she came down and hung out with them at CJ McCarthy's. And then after Chris texted them to say they were at the waterfall, I guess at that point, maybe John's friend had left. I'm not sure if that's the point when he went home. But so John and Karen made the short walk over to the waterfall. And that's when they joined up with the others. So that evidence suggests the idea of friction between Chris Albert and Colin Albert and John is probably a fiction. Now, we can't say for sure, but it's probably a fiction. All right. So let's, and also on returning to the defense witness list is John O'Keefe Sr. People shouldn't read into that. It just, John O'Keefe Sr., I believe, was in the house when Karen returned. And it sounds like possibly Karen and John Sr. had a good relationship before this happened. So they're probably going to call John in to say, as a character reference. Now, and it's so interesting. Now we get to this last part of the list. And this is where the defense has broken it down to expert list witnesses. So I don't know why. So I guess that guy from Tennessee, I don't know, because clearly some of the names on this list that I've already read were expert witnesses. So there was the guy from Tennessee, who I don't know who he is, but there's a bunch of troopers from the evidence lab. There's the Terry Kuhn from the USC Davis Veterinary Lab. So I don't know why that Terry Kuhn is not listed with the experts. Can we put any meaning onto that? Is Terry going to testify? But again, that's another indication that Terry Kuhn from the veterinary is department of UC is not going to testify, that that person is testifying as a prosecution expert, because the defense is not listing that person as one of their experts. So I don't know, maybe they're just going to question him in some other way, but not regarding his expertise on the wound. So the expert list is very short here for the defense, and that's not unusual, but they have to pay them. They don't have the resources of the state. So first is Frank Sheridan, who is a forensic pathologist from San Bernardino, California. I think that's where Alan Jackson is from, right? So he's going to test. He has already in the past said that the wounds on the arm were made from a dog. He has also said that John's injuries are not consistent or could not have been caused by a vehicle. Now, again, just have to be really, really cautious with defense experts. To a lesser degree, also with prosecution experts. But I've been on trials on a jury, and there are doctors and other types of experts that become professional testifiers. They get paid a lot of money to testify in these big cases, to the point where that's all they do. They no longer have to treat patients or do any work. It's a part of their income. So you really have to take with a grain of salt. I'd be curious to see, in fact, I should Google this, but what other cases, let me Google this right now and see if we can find out what other cases. That this doctor has testified in. I don't know if the information will come up. It may come up. What's this guy's name again? Sheridan, right? Frank Sheridan. Name cases, Frank. I go to Bing's version of ChatGPT, which sometimes is really useful in getting information. Name cases, Frank Sheridan, MD. Let's see, what was that, San Bernardino? Okay, Frank Sheridan, forensic. We'll see. This may or may not come up with anything. And so I asked, name cases where Frank Sheridan, forensic pathologist, has testified in. And we'll see if there's any answer on this. All right. We're getting an answer. Let's see what it says. Still writing. ChatGPT is a little bit slow today. Okay. Frank Sheridan is a well-respected forensic pathologist who has provided expert witness testimony in various wrongful death cases in California. So he's a guy that testifies a lot. He has a notable reputation for assisting attorneys in court with credible and defensible expert witness testimony. Assisting attorneys in court with credible and defensible expert witness testimony. I would think that probably means testifies for the defense, but it was worded oddly, so I'm not sure. It says one specific case where Dr. Sheridan testified is People versus Jennings, where he performed the autopsy and provided crucial testimony regarding the cause of death. His extensive experience and qualifications make him a sought after expert in the field of forensic pathology. All right, so again, this doesn't mean he's in any way suspicious or anything like that, but he's a guy that defense teams can count on. All right, so just keep that in mind. Next up on their list was Chris Van E. The last name is E. That's interesting. PhD, expert on biomedical and mechanical engineering from Michigan. Novi, Michigan. Also, Richard Green, as you know him, the expert in digital forensics from Florida. Daniel Wolf, PhD from ARCA Incorporated, ARCCA. I looked this up. They do a lot of, and their initial purpose of ARCA was to help make more safe vehicles. They have a bunch of engineers, and what they do is they bring in data and try to design safer vehicles. But they do also do expert testimony too. And there's actually three PhDs. Well, there's three people from ARCA testifying. One is Daniel Wolf, PhD. One is Andrew Rentschler, PhD. And then also Scotty Klein, BSME, Bachelor's in Science Medical Examiner. I don't know. I'm not sure what that means. So they are going to testify for the defense. And those presumably are the people that the feds hired. So we'll see what they say. And I don't see. So what's missing from this list? Well, let's, what I don't see, Lally mentioned in court the other day that the feds have a second expert that reported that the injuries to John are consistent with being hit by a vehicle. Now, unless I missed it, I don't see that expert on the list, on the prosecution list. I don't see anybody on that list that could be. Maybe I'm like, again, maybe I missed it. It's not like they're looking to say federal expert, but I didn't see anything on there for that. In addition, so who else? All right. So the Fed, Alan Jackson hinted in court the other day that they might bring in FBI agents to testify, but that's not at this time on their list. Now, this is not the complete list. This is the complete list of what they plan, but they can bring in experts later on rebuttal. So it's not like we have no chance of seeing any of these things. So for instance, if the defense brings in those experts hired by the feds and they testify and they say the injuries are not consistent with being hit by a car, then at that point, the prosecution could add the second expert. So at this point, they don't plan on bringing them in, but they could bring it in later on rebuttal. So that would probably be the plan. And the defense could do similar things too. There may be people on here that they haven't listed, but that they will add to the list during rebuttal. So, all right, we're getting late and I have to go shortly help bring the dogs to the vet. So let me just take a look at chat. And hopefully everything's been civil, especially with Tom Fleming having to go take his dog to the vet. So just give you an idea of the numbers. Yellow Cottage Tales, on YouTube right now, this has 100 viewers, and it has about 640 viewers on Twitter, and nobody is watching on Facebook. The waterfall is not behind DNA. I just went there 2 days ago. Okay. Eric says the waterfall is behind DNA. No, it's across the street and up, I'd say the equivalent of a block. We stood across. DNA is next to CJ McCarthy's. They're across from the Walgreens Plaza. We took a couple of pictures from across the street. And then we walked up to the waterfall. I'd say it's about a block, maybe a block and a half. There's a pretty cool waterfall there, like a manufactured waterfall that comes from, looks like a, I think there used to be industry in the area, and there's a feeder pond. And then they've created this steep waterfall into a canal in order to, would have been back at the time, to fuel the factories. It's really nice. The town of Canton was great. And you walked past that and a little down the road. So across the street is the waterfall. So no, it's not behind. Higgins text. This is just crazy, Shannon. I did see Yannetti say that. So Higgins texts John to come over to the party. Why is that suspicious? Why is that suspicious? It's an after hours party and you're saying, come on over. And think about the fact that he's got something going on with Karen. But, even the defense is not saying that that means necessary. The defense just had to put something up as a possibility. So for you to look at that and just sit there and go, aha, that's it. Well, what are you saying now? Because I guarantee that 2 months ago you were saying Higgins flipped. But now you're saying Higgins is actually the one that killed John. Which is it? So this is the defense is going to float all kinds of theories here, and there's going to be way more that are floated indirectly to confuse the public through people like Sean, who communicates daily with Karen, do an encrypted app. It's designed to fool people like you. So if you want to say that it's, why did Higgins text that? Is that odd? And you try to piece that into a larger narrative, okay. But if you look at that in isolation and say, aha, that's it. All you fools are fooled. That's crazy. It's nothing unnormal about texting a friend to come over and continue partying at an after-hours party. It's crazy. All right, so I guess I'm seeing here that from the Karen Reed people, boy, it's amazing. You guys can switch your theories on a dime, and that's okay if you're saying if 3 months ago you were saying, well, I think this happened, and now you think something else happened. Well, that's okay, that's normal. But if 3 months ago you were sure of scenario ABC, sure of it. And so sure of it that you come on here and tell me that I'm crazy for not believing it. And you would, right? Now, because the defense has floated a different theory, you go with theory XYZ, which completely reverses ABC. You go with that theory and you have the same, and without even remembering how sure you were about ABC, you go with XYZ and you say, you're crazy for not believing that. Don't you have any sense of skepticism? Don't you have any sense of, all right, I've switched my theories here, so maybe we're not sure what happened. The defense is just throwing out stuff that might stick to create reasonable doubt. It in no way shows that those scenarios happened. So 3 months ago, and for many months, everybody was saying Higgins flipped, that John was killed by Colin inside the house. Now, just because Unetti raised the possibility of Higgins with a message like that and a couple other odd things, now without even any regret, you're going to sit there and say, Higgins did it. So maybe you think Higgins jumped him outside, right? Because John's phone never went in the house. Okay, it's reasonable to speculate about all these things. But I find it really odd that you're so sure to the point of insulting me, because I don't see that XYZ as being crystal clear that it's obvious Higgins did it. If Higgins killed John O'Keefe, Higgins did not flip. Okay, because he's the murderer. You don't flip if you're the murderer. If Higgins tried to set up John to be killed, he doesn't flip because there's no deal that anybody's going to make with him that doesn't result in him going to jail essentially for the rest of his life. It's not like Higgins could plot with the Alberts to kill John and set him up by getting him to go to the house, being there for the murder as an ATF agent, and then taking actions to cover it up. You think there's some deal Higgins could make that he would stay out of jail? No. And he knows this. He would go to jail for the better part of his life, the rest of his life. He's a guy in his 40s. The sentence would be long. Even if he decided to cooperate, the sentence would be long enough that he would die in jail. So there's no way that if Higgins actually was a part of setting up John, participated in the killing of John, participated in the cover-up, there is no way that he flipped. So why were you saying, why were you so sure that he flipped a month ago, a week ago? If you're really sure about something, and then it turns out that that was wrong, and so now you're going to be sure about something else, shouldn't you at least question your own ability to weigh evidence? Shouldn't you say, okay, maybe I shouldn't have been so sure? And if you shouldn't have been so sure about the last theory, then maybe you shouldn't be so sure about this theory, right? I mean, if you really, really, really believed with a 100% certainty that if you believed with a 100% certainty that Higgins was just a witness to something in the that happened in the house, and then later on he felt bad about it and he flipped and went to the feds and cut a deal. If that's what you believed then, and you were sure about it, but now you believe that Higgins actually helped plot and participate and cover up in the murder, that's a very different thing. So that means you were wrong about what you were sure about last week. The thing that you were 100% sure about last week, you were wrong about. So doesn't that give you a sense of caution about that thing that you're 100% sure about now? If you could be that wrong back then, a week ago, a month ago, 6 months ago, shouldn't you at least exercise some caution about what you're sure about now? This is what bothers me about this case. People are way too sure about things that you go from seeing that Higgins had, you know, a 22-second call with Brian Albert. Aha, that's it. That's the murder conspiracy. No, you're just arguing to a conclusion. You already believe, for whatever personal reasons, that the state is lying and Karen is innocent and that there's a huge cover-up. That's your core belief, and you're not going to give it up no matter what. So now every other piece of evidence, you're going to try to fit into that and go, aha, that proves it. That's not a logical way to process evidence. And this is the biggest problem that I have with this case. And this is what I think it's so important here. And I'm sorry, I do think that I have a role in helping some people in the public here. Because if you can't process things logically, it's going to affect the way you deal with other cases. It affects how you deal with politics. It affects how you deal with your own life. You might be very good at other things in life, but you're not good at being logical. And I'm trying to help. All right, so it's not logical to be so sure about these odd little bits of evidence when you already have easily proved pieces of evidence. You're going to see at 8:22 that the taillight was in pieces. You're going to see that it was no chance really to tamper with that taillight. You're going to see so many people that would have to be involved in this conspiracy have not ever broken ranks and come clean and gone to the feds and say, yeah, there was a conspiracy. Nobody has. So this is just foundational logic that should at least give you a sense of skepticism about this conspiracy theory. Now, maybe you still believe there was something funny that was going on. Okay. Maybe you're not sure. Okay. That's good. It's good to not be sure in life, especially when none of us has seen all the evidence. Presumably, we'll see all the useful evidence or most of the useful evidence in trial. But it just drives me crazy that people are so determined to believe something that they just take these little tiny pieces and cram them, force them into their theory. It's just crazy. You shouldn't think that way. Start developing a sense of skepticism. What about the missing 42 minutes of footage at the police station? Yes, Joe. And as I said before, we all know from our real life experience that it's very common when something happens at a police station that the police don't want to be seen. It seems like the video goes missing, right? Now, I'm not saying that that's always the case. There's probably a lot of times when video just goes missing because it doesn't record. You know, these systems aren't perfect. So we haven't seen any evidence on this. We just had a description by, I think it was Unetti on that one, and then a response by Lally. We don't know. We have to see it. But for me, if you have clear evidence that of the taillight at 8:22, missing pieces, then it doesn't matter what happened in the garage. That's just logic. That's just logic. If the taillight was, I mean, unless the guys in the garage also had a time machine and went back to before 8:22, it doesn't matter. So what if that video was deleted suspiciously? I don't know. But if that, and I've now talked to multiple sources that say that those images of the taillight at 8:22 from the dash cam recorder of a cruiser that pulled, this is daylight, that pulled up right behind Karen's SUV at 8:22, that they're crystal clear and they show the condition of the taillight and they show the pieces missing. So if that's the case, it doesn't really matter what happened in the garage. Now, when I say it doesn't matter, I don't mean that we shouldn't try to get to the bottom of it. Was there something else going on in there? You know, I don't know. But you know, could there be an innocent explanation for why the motion triggered camera didn't get triggered at that point? I don't know the answer to that, but I do know that they didn't tamper if they couldn't. And if the taillight was already in the same condition at 8:22, what tampering could they have done to that taillight at 5:30 or 6 o'clock or whatever time? And in addition, there was no time. The car didn't get there until 5:36. So Yannetti describes it as pinged, that it went into the garage at 5:36. That's interesting to me. So when he says pinged, what does that mean? Does that mean they got a GPS read on it? I don't know. He didn't explain it, but he just said pinged. So the SUV arrived within the garage at 5:36. The main piece of the taillight was dug out from deep within the snow at 5:45. So now we can question whether that time was accurate. But unless it's off by like an hour, there was no way to plant evidence. And the time is only part of the explanation as to why there was no way to plant evidence. The key thing to understand, what was the earliest that the alleged conspirators could have arrived at 34 Fairview? It's a 5-minute drive from the police station. So the car, it's in the garage at 5:36. So let's say you've managed to somehow miraculously tamper with those pieces. Give it 2 minutes. Say they're really fast, right? And then you get in your car and you race to the crime scene. So you get there, what, say around 5:43 or something like that. And so maybe you think that 5:45 listing of when the main taillight piece was found is inaccurate. But what was there at that time at 5:43 when we're saying that maybe someone could have arrived there? Were there news trucks there? Because there's news trucks from at least WBZ. I've seen footage from CBS, but I'm not sure if they were just reusing. But so at least the WBZ news truck was there. And those guys get there 45 minutes to an hour before they film, at least because they have to set up. What time were those guys there? What time was the CERT team there from the state police? Those guys have to set up and set up their lightings. And in the WBZ footage, we see the street is packed with cars and they all have their lights on. So into that situation, there is no way for a conspirator to march into the yard, into the snow, and start burying taillight pieces. Bury them, because they had to be buried deep. This was found in the old snow that Lucky plowed. So the only way you could have that conspiracy is if all those people on the CERT team were in on it. And that's just extremely unlikely. Okay, I have to end this now, guys. I apologize I didn't get to the questions, but I have to... Actually, you know what I can do? I can take myself out and leave this on in chat so you guys can talk for a little while. But I have to cut out because I have to go help with the dogs.